Okay. Okay, we are live. Hey, my loves, it's Rochi, aka the Frugalista Mom, and once again, welcome to Getting Candid with Rochi. And tonight is very special because my guest and I decided to move our usual time slot, the 3 p.m., into 8 p.m. so that we could accommodate viewers from the other side of the globe. Yes, we are also live in the Philippines, in Asia, and other parts of the world. So right now it's early morning in there. It's around 8 o'clock. So hopefully we would have those comments in there. And don't forget to give us some hearts, some likes, and also feel free to ask questions down below. So without further ado, today's topic is something that I know is very close to our hearts. It's about parents and what we call online learning, distance learning, or the new type of learning wherein the kids will be staying at home and doing it via Zoom or Google Live or whatever from their teachers. So tonight's guest is a power couple. I've known them since college, but I'm not gonna tell you what year. Right? And I've been a witness in their love story, so it's good. Well, we've stayed in touch in Facebook for a long time, and then I'm glad that last year they were able to move up here in New Jersey. And I'm happy that we are able to reconnect again. And now we were not just talking about ourselves, but our children as well. So, without further ado, please welcome my guest for tonight, Mr. Marvin Agustin and Mrs. Josephine Agustin. Hi, Marv. Hi,
Hello, good evening.
Chapai. Good
Hello,
evening.
good evening. Hi,
Hello.
thank you for
Hi.
inviting me. So,
Oh, I'm very happy to have you in the show. Remember last time I told you we're gonna have a Facebook Live, Marvin? I kept my word.
yes.
Yes. showbiz. So now, aside from being parents, I thought of inviting you tonight because I know you are a pro when it comes to helping your kids adjust to school. You know, because in my case, I have 4 kids. Two of my first 2 kids, they were able to go to the Philippines for 2 months and study there in a preschool. And then they attended preschool here in New Jersey. They spent a couple of years in Catholic school and then public school. And then my oldest went to high school early during her freshman year in high school in a Catholic school. So, and then she went back to, what's that, public school again. So, you know, every type of school, there's an adjustment. And I think you guys, from what I heard and what I've read, your kids have been in 3 countries, am I right? Or 3 continents when it comes to their schooling.
Two continents lang.
No,
No,
three.
three. Oh, yeah,
Three.
three.
Yeah,
Three continents.
3 continents and what? 4 countries? Three countries.
Yes, three countries and three
In 3 different
continents.
continents.
Yeah.
Uh, well, Josephine, can you tell us more about that? Where have they studied? What countries?
Okay, so our firstborn, Paolo, he was able to go to play school
In
in
the
the
Philippines.
Philippines where he was born. And then when he was 3, we moved to Luxembourg, which is in Europe, because of Marvin's work. We stayed there for 3 years. So Paolo attended the local school there. It was called Precos, but it's actually preschool until kinder, right? Until he was 5. And then when he entered into grade 1, that's the time we moved to Singapore. So he also joined the local school there. And Niccolo was born in Luxembourg, so his first experience of school was in Singapore.
Singapore, Luxembourg also.
No, he went to a
Preschool,
daycare.
daycare.
Daycare. He went, Niccolo, our second born son,
Play
went
school.
into daycare on part-time in Luxembourg. Then we moved to Singapore when he was 3. Then he attended preschool and then kinder, and then his primary years were there. His first 3 years in primary school was there in Singapore, in a Filipino-run school, which was an international school where I worked as well. Tapos yon, we moved to here in the U.S. and now they're both in the local school, the public school.
Wow, that's way too much. I mean, in my case, I spent all my kindergarten until high school in one school and then college. So that's basically not much adjustment. But on their part, they've been like jumping not only from one school, but from one country to the next, right? So during those times, who do you consider as the primary school parent? You know, the one who's in charge of the homework, for yelling at kids if they have low grades.
It's me.
You.
Yes.
Okay. At that time, I think you were handling, you're also working, you know, you're working and then you're still in charge of the homework. So how did that go? I mean, how do you balance that? How do you take care of that?
Stressful. But I think it's really more on being intentional about it, knowing that when I get home, I still have to do this responsibility. And so I prepare myself. But it's not easy, of course. When I get home, I bring with me the stress from the work, and I need to calm down and settle down. And then we start checking if Paolo has homework and what he's doing. And so that's where the difficulty comes in, because it's not easy to just shut off from your work and then suddenly you'll become a teacher and then be calm and happy and encouraging. Of course not. I'll be honest, it's not easy for me and it's not easy for Paolo. But as he learns, I also learn. I am learning how to teach him, and he's also learning how I'm teaching him. So it worked both ways. So I guess what makes it work is we talk about it. We always discuss. And yeah, I yell or get frustrated, but we see to it that we talk about his homework. We talk about our dynamics and how we communicate with one another. That sometimes Papa is so tired, and just be patient with me. I would admit it to him and I will apologize, and he too will talk to me about it. So from then on, we have this kind of, let's say, a parent-teacher son relationship. And Niccolo. So when we were in Singapore, I don't know, I like to check how they're doing in school, and to see if they did something good, or let's say they did well in a test or whatever, to encourage them, to give them a good feedback. And if they miss out something, then they will hear something from me as well. So what we want to establish is that, yes, you're studying and we see you and we're here with you. You're not alone in your studies. So they know that we're looking at them. Yes.
Oh, that is really nice. It's really nice to have somebody or a parent or both parents getting involved on that. Because I know here in the U.S., a lot of parents don't, I mean, I can't blame them, but they're not as involved when it comes to their kids. Because, you know, it is hard. You've had a long day at work or sometimes overtime. So most of them are really like, you know, waiting for a tutor or somebody else to do the schooling with the kids. Now, speaking of the new school, I know we're both in New Jersey, and last spring we have a dose or a preview of what remote learning is. At first, I really liked it. I mean, actually, I really like it. It's not even at first, because our school was able to prepare at least before they cut the classes, because it was around I think the schools were off Tuesday, but before they made the announcement Friday, our district already decided to give a break to the kids. They actually they sent the kids home on Friday so that teachers would have some preparations for the following week. So they were able to provide Chromebooks to everybody, you know, all they were able to prepare on that day lessons for 1 week, for at least 1 week. So when Monday came, when they said that the next day is no more school, there's already a program in place. And those who weren't able, because at that time, only the sixth graders and the high school, you know, sixth graders and up has free Chromebooks. So, So around Monday, those who have no access to computers, they were able to get Chromebooks for the lower grades, which I think is not that chaotic. Then I'm also very happy because my kids are in advanced math. I'm happy that there are teachers there because I have no intentions of teaching advanced algebra or geometry or whatever math there is, because I'm so bad at it. And I know, Marvin, you know that, but I'm bad at it. Yeah, he used to be my motivator in algebra.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Oh, he almost made me cry. First term freshman year. we'll tell you the story next time. Yeah, he actually motivated me so much that I told him, I'm not going to fail.
Wow, that's good.
It's very good because I owe him that uno, that one. Okay, so what's your experience when it during that time? In when we had our distance learning back in spring, what do you think are the advantages, Marvin?
I think advantage one is that you know that they'll be safe. They'll not they'll not get the virus, and maybe the first week was let's say, wow, this is just okay. It's nothing unusual, or we were still hoping that the following week they'll go back to their normal school days, but it never came. And I think, yeah, the first week was okay, but then later on, we knew and understood that we had to plan it out already, especially with the younger one. So I guess this is what I meant a while ago by intentional, being intentional with the education of the children, because this is just a follow through of what we've been doing with our children. It's not easy to teach algebra, just like you said, but if you teach them in their first, let's say, first 5 years of their school lives, once they reach middle school, it will be easier for us to let them study on their own, which means you have to invest time with the small children and teach them the skills and know how to, you know, to solve some problems. So with our eldest, Paolo, is 13 in middle school, it wasn't that difficult because he can do it on his own. We just have to monitor him on what he's doing and his assignments. But for the younger one, our Nicolo was just grade four, we needed to sit down with him and really discuss one by one what he needed to do each day, every day, with the time, schedule, and a to-do list. And because it's still not part of his skill, I think. Of course, it's not an automatic skill. It is a learned skill. So we have to patiently sit down with Nicolo in the morning and ask him one by one what he needed to do. So at that time, we realized that this will go on for several months, a longer month. But so the good thing is that we're prepared for it now. I mean, that one prepared us for this coming school year. We know now that this is what's going to work with our middle school son, and this is what can help our elementary grade 5, incoming grade 5 son. So yeah, it gave us an idea on how to do it and what to do. Yeah.
Actually, for Nicolo, it's not that he didn't have the right habits, but it's more like he has a different behavior when he's at school and when he's at home. So at home, he's really like, how do you say it? He's free spirited. He's spontaneous. Yeah, and so he tends to be easily distracted, or his creative mind is on the go all the time. So he gets easily distracted when he's at home, because he feels there are a lot of things that he'd rather do, like make his own video, create his own story, draw, yawn. But when he's at school, feedback from the teacher told us that he's actually well behaved. And he's quiet. He doesn't move around so much. He's actually quiet. So we're like, what? So when home-based learning or online learning started for him here in New Jersey a few months back, it was a big adjustment for Nicolo that he's studying at home, and he didn't automatically bring his school habits at home because he was more comfortable here. So Marvin, with the help of Marvin, I was just a supporting role. With the help of Marvin, he was able to make sure that Nicolo had a routine, that he had some structure to follow.
Okay, so what do you think are the disadvantages of homeschooling? And not really homeschool, but online learning? You know. For me, I would say one of the disadvantages for me is that the interaction. Because, you know, they have group work and all that stuff, or they would, because I would say some kids are good to be with other kids and, cooperate to do a project. But now they are all in front of the computer. So I think that's one of the challenges that I see, or the disadvantage that online learning has. How about on you, on your part, what do you think are the challenges?
One is the gadgets.
The tool themselves.
In school, at least they're really monitored by the teacher, at least monitored, especially the young one. But at home, they have their Chromebook and then an access to their cell phone or TV. So there's a lot of distraction, and it's difficult. That's a very challenging, and you really have to exert an effort to help them to stay focused. Yeah. So the distraction, distraction, and how to cope and how to help them manage the distraction. That's the disadvantage.
Yeah.
Or the challenge.
Actually, I considered myself, I told my friends before, I feel like I'm a call center manager when the pandemic started, or when their schooling started, because I have four kids. Each of them are in their own separate gadget. They have their own Chromebook and laptop. So at first, the bigger ones want to stay in the bedroom, because they have access to Wi-Fi all over the house. I said, no, two of you are all of them are actually in the living room. Two are by the dining table and two by the couch. So at first, there was one thing that I learned, probably it's in day one or day two. I saw them that one, because they all have their earphones. So I don't even understand, I don't even know what they're talking or if they are actually online. So there was one time one of the boys were smiling and laughing. He was very happy. So I was like, why? What's up with the class? Why is he so happy? And then when I looked at him, he's already on YouTube on a different tab. And I'm like, are you kidding me? And he's like, oh, I'm sorry. It's like, yeah, because every time, when I look at him, he would put it in a tab with his teacher because he already took the attendance, and then he would switch. And I said, that's not a good sign. And then I realized he's not the only one doing it. The siblings are actually doing it. So when I was there, that's when I started really like paying attention, moving around between computers just to check what they're doing. And I said, you know what? I learned that trick already, so don't do it. Don't do it anymore. But I think that's why for some people, I want to discuss it because some parents might think, oh, my child is very, very nice, you know, enjoying school. Then you just realize they're actually not in school because they're already on a separate, they're on YouTube or separate tab. So parents, take note. Check the tabs of their Chromebooks or their laptops, right? You, Jopai, I think you've been with younger kids, right? I mean, your work as a preschool teacher, and I think you're back, right?
Yeah, I'm working. I'm back at work.
Yeah, you're back at work. So what do you think are the advantages of, you know, because you are there with the kids. So what do you think are the advantages and the disadvantages of online learning, especially to the younger kids, from your experience?
I would say that, there are pros and cons. So, of course, in classroom learning is preferred actually for preschoolers because it's all about the relationship and, you know, staying, you know, their attention span is so short. So, you know, if you're in person, it's easy to feel them, to see them, to know what they're going through, and to take them through the learning journey with you. But if it's online, the story is totally different because one moment, of course, they'll be excited. Wow, my teacher is on TV. So are my classmates. It would be a new experience for them. So that's an advantage. And since most of them are familiar with gadgets, so they would be like, oh, they're in my gadgets. So there's novelty in the idea and the experience. However, the disadvantage is also in terms of keeping the attention span as well. So that's why it's recommended that parents be with their child when there's online learning. And the sessions should be shorter. So that's how it is. But then because of the novelty, it's like they feel like school is at home or they're bringing their home to school. So they have a lot to share. Like, this is what I had for cereal. This is my breakfast. This is my toy. So everything, they have a lot to share. It's like it opens doors of new stories for them. It opens up their life to their class and their teacher. However, there is a need like to monitor who speaks and, you know, because the class dynamics changes. There is a need also to orient the parents on how the flow should go before the session starts. So, yeah. And one thing that I know is that when it's online and they are noisy, you can immediately mute all of them and you're the only one talking. That's an advantage.
Oh, that's a big advantage.
You can control the discomfort. Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah. Now, speaking of social interaction, how do you manage, you know, because we're still like on, well, not on lockdown, but we're still limited in our interactions. And of course, you know, in school, they won't, for those who are going to school, you know, because some districts are actually opening like a hybrid system. How do you maintain your children's, I never asked pala. Hybrid or are you gonna go all remote?
For us, we chose actually, well, they'll turn out with hybrid. They are starting with remote until October, mid-October, and then the district will see from there.
Okay, so we are in the same situation then. So I just want to ask, how do you deal with or
Oh no, it's a bit choppy.
We're losing you, Rochi.
We're losing the signal.
Okay. Actually, we're good.
Oh, then okay, it's our signal.
Keep on talking. Yeah. Did you get my last question?
No, but we do have some questions.
Yeah, it's okay. How about their social life? How do you manage to help them with their social life?
This is it. No. So parang what we did to compensate for the lack of social interaction. So what we did was we drew them closer to home. So like when we could, Marvin would take the boys outside to the nearest park. And at first the only family who was playing basketball without the ring, because there was a time the district took out the ring and the net. So there was just the basketball board. So he was very patient in playing with Paolo, bringing out the boys. Eventually I would go with them. So that was like, we brought them into the center of the family. So our relationship grew such that it didn't really, they didn't feel the lack of not being, known or having interactions as outside of school or TV, because they had us. Also, Marvin would encourage them to speak to their friends and to their grandparents who are in the Philippines or relatives. Yeah, Marvin, you want to ask?
Yeah, so for both of them, they have friends in different countries, like in Singapore. And also, they're classmates here. So I really tell them, why don't you get in touch with this friend? At first, they don't want to. But later on, they started to become open with idea, because it's not just them. It's not unique to them that they're separated from their classmates. It's something normal to all the children right now. So what they feel about being connected to someone that need to be connected to a friend or to their classmates is actually what the other child is feeling as well. So the other children want to be connected to their friends as well. So it's easy if I ask a parent or a teacher, why can we connect our children to their children? It's not difficult for them to be, to start chatting. So we allow them to chat, but of course we monitor, especially the young one, and we encourage them to get in touch not only with their classmates here in Edison, but also with their friends in the Philippines and in Singapore. So physically they're not seeing each other, but at least because of technology, and I think it's okay. It's their generation right now. They're the
techie generation.
I guess seeing each other through video calls or just chatting with them help them to be connected. And just like what Josephine said, we have a lot of time to go to the park. And just recently, Nicolo saw another boy in the park by himself. So the two of them introduced each other. introduced each other, so they started playing. So one by one, but I told them if the group becomes a big group, then we cannot. I don't allow them to go with other people, but so we let them see other people. We don't discourage them to check on their friends, and if there's a chance to meet new friends in the park or basketball, I let them, as long as just a few, very few people.
Very 6 feet apart, right? Yeah. Now, I know we've had our, I would say we were the experimental group back in spring and summer for remote learning. So I just want to ask you, do you have any expectations now that, the school districts at least have an idea what's going on in online learning. Any expectations on the school, on other parents, on your kids?
Well, I think this is it. This is the real thing now. It will start next week. Yeah. And yeah, I think we have to have that mindset and the right perspective that when we start the school, it's not just me or the parents teaching their kids or monitoring their kids. We have to work with the school. So whatever things that we think is lacking or if our kids need some support from the school, we have to be proactive. We contact the school, ask them, and if case the teacher also, I believe, if they see some behavior or if they need some homework or tests or whatever, we expect them to tell us the feedback, because it will only work if the parents and the teachers will help each other. If not, I think if that communication is not established well, there'll be a problem. Yeah, I
agree with you, because you know what? This is really new to us parents, this type of learning. It's also new to the teachers, because most of them haven't done it or were not trained to do it. In, you know, even though they have how many years of experience in the classroom, it's hard really to talk to a screen, and actually you can't really see what your students are doing or what are their concerns. I think it's also a struggle for them. That's why it's important to work together as a team. Now, speaking of tips on how to deal with this new learning, new type of schooling, Jopai, can you tell us more about Turo Summit and what is it all about?
Yes, Turo Summit is an online resource. It's a series, it's a number of talks given by 33 speakers from different parts of the world. And the speakers are a combination of teachers, experts, parents. We have parents who are working parents, entrepreneurs, homeschooling parents. We also have clinical psychologists, a nutritionist, and a physical therapist, and a doctor. So we have different kinds of people and motivational speakers that will provide tips in very brief, bite-sized talk. That will give tips, strategies for educators like parents or teachers on how to support their home-based learners, meaning learners who will be on remote learning or virtual learning, or those who opt to go to homeschooling. Yeah, so it's available. It's still available. It was streamed live last July 31st until August 2nd, but the talks are still available, and anyone who still wants to avail of it may do so by simply going to https://go.turosummit.com. Yeah, and all the talks are still available until September 2nd. And we also have a Facebook, which has continuous resources and question and answer sessions with the speakers. And the Facebook is Facebook Turo Learn. Ano nga ba? Supporting learners of today. Supporting learners of today. There. Sorry.
It's okay. For those who are watching, don't worry. I will post the links with this video after we finish the streaming, so you won't miss it. And for those who are not Filipinos, can you tell them what Turo means?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Turo in Filipino is a verb and a noun. So as a noun, it means lesson. So, you know, the lessons like what teachers give, what they plan for every day, every school year. And as a verb, it means to teach, to give a lesson, or even to point, to literally point with your finger, like to show the way. So Filipinos like to do that. We like to point with our with our fingers. Yeah, or especially with our lips, right? So when you put it together, Turo is the summit. We use that word because it's meant to show people the way and provide lessons that will help people and guide them through this time of transitioning into home-based learning and distance learning or virtual learning.
Now, for those who are also non-Filipinos, please tell them more about the sessions. Are they all in English?
Oh, yes. I think, yeah, all the talks are in English except one, which is has some Tagalog or Filipino words in them. So we call it Taglish, which is a combination of English and Tagalog words. So only one speaker out of the 33 spoke in Taglish, but generally his main message was very clear and it was in English, but he had some Tagalog or Filipino words infused in them.
Yeah, because I actually watched some of the summit talks and I find it very, very helpful as a parent. And I think also for some educators as well, it's very helpful. One of my favorite ones is the one with, I forgot his name, but he's the one who does math tutoring.
Oh yeah, that's Math Agility by Mike Espina. Yeah. And that's very nice because he's the founder of that framework. He designed it and he's based in California.
Yeah, because I remember, you know, see, I have that thing with math until now. I'm traumatized with that. And guess what, right? Because the world has some ways to get to joke back at me. All my kids are in advanced math.
So, good for you.
So anyway, I really like that because he already discussed some systems that the kids would, you know, will be very useful. Especially with the new math, because I know our math is not the same math that they're learning right now. So I think it's a very good resource. And also there was, is there one talk that was about, I think it was something about homeschool, about planning when your child is learning. Can you talk more about that? I think her talk was about, you know, setting your home, like,
setting it up. Yes, how to prepare your home for home-based learning. Yes, that was given by Janessa, or her nickname is Sang Piscos. She's based in New Brunswick, Canada. She is a preschooler teacher as well as she has experience in being a homeschooling mom. And she said, like, to prepare it, she took both approaches, like, to make sure that you begin with love and don't be pressured by the lessons, but you have to be a parent first. You begin with reminding yourself that it's your home and there is no place like home. There's no place to learn except at your home. And she also takes a preschooler that focuses on playing. So make sure that it's engaging, that you engage your children into learning and refresh their minds through creativity after really thorough lessons. And she also is an advocate for positive parenting. So yon, she always focuses on keeping the relationship together. And also to prepare it, she said to, what did she say? She also said that with the homeschooling approach is also to follow the lead of your child. So, follow their lead.
You know what? That is something that I think most parents should put into heart, especially now, because we have expectations. And sometimes, you know, if our kids are fall below on that set expectation, we give them more pressure. And now that they're home, instead of being yelled at by the mom when they get home, they're already being yelled at or being reprimanded or being traumatized already. that, you know, that exact minute. And I think that's one way that we could help our kids to let them, you know, work on their own pace. Because I know, I mean, teachers do that. I think, you know, teachers has that ability to see. But I think for most of us who've never been, well, Marvin and I, like, who've never been in a classroom setting every day, we don't know how to handle what learning really is. So that was nice. So, one more thing. I think they have to pay for the summit, right? To get the videos, the replay.
Yes.
Can you tell us more?
Oh, yeah. It's nice that you mentioned that the videos are on replay until September 2, and you can watch it on demand. So if you want to do that, and please do avail of it, because all our speakers really worked hard for it to help parents in this transition. Just go to our website, which Rochi will put in the comments. And the price is at $1,025
something.
Yeah, 1,495 pesos, or close to $30. Yeah.
Yeah. So I want to make sure that you know, those who are going to that website won't get scared, because the monetary value there is in Philippine pesos. And right now, I think the exchange rate of dollar to pesos is around like 40 plus, between 45 to 50 pesos. So roughly, it's about $30. So don't get scared. It's not $1,000 for the whole summit.
I'm sorry about that. $30. Because when we made the summit, it was primarily for families in the Philippines. But then we realized that, yes, just as Rochi benefited from it, other families can too. So there are also other families that are in, we have 20% of the families outside of the Philippines who did avail of the summit, and they totally recommend it. Everyone who attended it said that they would recommend it 100%.
Actually, I am actually recommending it 100%, because
you.
I've seen, I didn't finish all the sessions, because I keep repeating some of the other sessions. But I find it very helpful, because, you know, some of them are actually educators who are, you know, who are experienced in teaching kids. And, you know, some of them are in the upper grades or the lower grades. They were very, very, I would say their talks is very practical.
Yes.
You know, they don't say highfalutin words or anything. It's really what you can do in a short period of time. You can get like 2 or 3 tips and you're good. So that's what one thing I like. And then if you caught something and then you miss it, it's nice to go back, right?
Thanks.
So don't forget, guys, we will put the link for the Turo Summit, and hope you will watch it or take a good look at it. And I know you'll find it very helpful, right? So do we have any more surprises, Jopai?
Oh, yeah. And thank you for asking that, because starting on August 31st, or that will be August 30th here in the U.S., we would have our Facebook group, which is called Go Turo Team. So this Facebook group will be open to all those who avail of an all-in access pass, meaning they sign up for the summit, the Turo Summit, online summit. And when they do, we will have another learning journey that will start on the last day of August. We will have lessons on math, character formation, planting positive seeds in your children. And we'll have a long, different various discussions on, you know, teaching and parenting as well. Yeah. Oh, we're losing you.
Hello. You got stuck.
Then
I'm sorry, Rachi, we cannot. Hi.
Rachi.
Coming? They're here. We're back.
Oh yeah, we're back. Sorry.
Okay, it's also on my part. I think it's a Jersey thing, right?
Yeah.
And anyway, before we end, I just want to ask Josephine and Marvin, like, one of those food for thought or a special message to the parents who are getting ready or have been or have started going remote learning with their children. What can you say to them? Any words of wisdom? Advice? Tip?
Hey, for me, okay. I'll start with myself. One thing that I learned would be about mirror neurons, meaning, you know how they say that whatever anxiety the parent feels, whether even if you don't communicate it, your child feels it. It somehow, you know, resonates or reflects through them as well. So my advice is, as much as possible, do not fear, and try to think positive thoughts or think, you know, define your what success means for you in this season, and focus on your relationship and the well-being of the family and your children, and find creative ways on how to make it work, because it will be difficult, but it's possible. And I would suggest, like, be creative, like, think out of the box, because there are many solutions when you think creatively. And this is like unprecedented times, so it needs unprecedented measures and you know, ways. So like for us, what I did was, okay, let's exercise, or okay, I'd hug them more. So more than the stress, they get more input of love. So yeah, focus on the relationship, be creative so that you're open to other possibilities, other unprecedented possibilities and solutions. And yeah, so be creative in your approach as well by, you know, filling their love tank.
You. Yes. Yeah, for me, Josephine mentioned it will be challenging. It is difficult, especially if you have not been into the education of your kids. You left it the education with the school, but now you're confronted with a situation that you have to be part of it. So, might as well have this mind shift already that you're part of their education right now and your kids need you. It's not something that you just let them do what they want and then expect them to get something or get them that they'll get high grades, but have this perspective that they need you. And don't be afraid. Don't give up on your children. And it's all about relationship, which means try to get to know your children better, especially their learning styles. One style is not necessarily sure to be the style of another child. They will be different. I'm sure Rochi
has four.
Yeah, they have four different styles. So it's not one catch-all style, which means you have to get to know your kids. How they respond to stress, what works with them. Like our son Nicolo is more creative, so when he's stressed, we let him
move around.
And the other one is more really let's say into academics and logic, and if we want him to follow a strict time, like you have to do this at 8 o'clock, 8:30, it will not work with him. So he has his own pace.
And rhythm.
Yes. And yeah, if we didn't know about this, I think it's gonna be difficult. So get to know your kids, their learning style. Ask them and give them this door, an open door that, hey, if you need something, I'm here to help you. So they'll not be afraid to ask if they need help. Because if they need help and their teacher's not there, there's no one to help them. It's added stress. And when your children are stressed, for sure you'll be stressed as well.
So if the parents are stressed, if the children are stressed, you will be stressed.
I know. Thank you so much. Now for me, I think my last words for this episode will be make sure to be part of the team. Yeah. Because why? Because this is something new for all of us, parents, educators, students, even the grandmothers who take care of their grandchildren, or who are like just to monitor, you know, to watch them while they're doing their homeschooling. It is very new. So I guess instead of being negative about it, or if we have concerns, let's talk to the other team members on what's going on. Because if we just start, you know, it's either we break the team or we build the team. So when it comes to online learning, let's just be a team, right? And thank you guys once again. Thank you so much, Jopai or Josephine. And thank you so much, Marvin, for sharing with us your, I would say not cents, but so ready dollars tonight. And thank you. And hopefully I can have you again in our show. And great. Hopefully I could see you soon. Okay.
All so right. Thank you.
Bye.
To be here. Thank you, Rachi, for this experience.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you so much, guys. It's the we just ended the episode, and just a reminder, we are on YouTube, and if you are on YouTube, please don't forget to like or to subscribe. And also, next week we'll have another juicy episode, so watch out. It will be on Wednesday next week, and it's at 3 p.m. So thank you so much, and hope to see you soon. Bye. What are we?